from the countries of Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador. And this isn't going to end. So their very hope was realized when they came to the border, were welcomed with open arms by President Obama. And now they have the audacity to fly these unaccompanied juveniles not back to their home country, but to Arizona and other states around our country in secrecy.
Right.
And bringing them in. And they're scratching their heads wondering why people in local communities are upset when they completely ignored the promise of Jay Johnson, the current Secretary of Homeland Security, that he promised under oath last week before Congress that he would coordinate with all state and local officials. That never happened. So now, of course, these media liberals are saying somehow now it's my fault.
Right. Now, Sheriff, I know that as a elected official and as a law enforcement official, you get information all the time that you don't release to the public because of investigative concerns and whatnot. But you decided to release this information. And you more than just released it, I mean, I've read and I assume it's true, you've contacted some people in the community that would be likely to stage a protest. So talk to me about your decision-making process there. Why did you release the information, and what did you expect would happen once you released the information?
The public and certainly law enforcement has a right to know this information. I was contacted by two federal agents who are whistleblowers in Homeland Security that, Sheriff, you need to know this, and they expressed grave concerns about not only the public safety, but about public health. And they said, they're sending them out on this Tuesday or this Monday, and nothing, no formal communication from DHS. I called, I emailed, I sent snail mail letters, and no reply whatsoever.
So been there myself.
The academy down in Oracle, and they actually confirmed this, that in fact they hired 30 additional staff to prepare for the 40 to 50, they said, unaccompanied juveniles. So I shared this information with the public, letting the community know. How outraged do you think members of the community who do have these legitimate concerns would be if I concealed this information and kept it secret from the public?
Right. Well, as a journalist,
I would
say
outraged.
Right. As a journalist, I would say I want the information. But Sheriff, what other you also contacted some people privately. And so let me just ask you straight out, let's let our hair down here. And by the way, I'm as bald as you are. Okay. So letting our hair down and total truth between us, you contacted some people that you know. Did you expect that would lead to a protest?
In fact, that didn't happen. And this is where misinformation is being put out by the Arizona Republic and others without confirming this information. I was at a luncheon. I was speaking to women in leadership at the NRA luncheon in Tucson, in North Tucson.
Right.
And I freely shared this information publicly.
Right.
And criticizing the federal government's overreach and authority and power. And I said, and they just think they can send people. And I said, their latest is they're sending 40 to 60 unaccompanied juveniles here to my county, and they've never even called me. So that was public. I even held a town hall in Saddlebrook. We had over 300 members of the community. All of them weren't against this. Many people there were in favor of these unaccompanied juveniles coming here. So
right. That's correct. Yeah.
I stood and answered these questions from all sides.
Okay, so you didn't pick up the phone and call friends of yours that you knew would probably instigate a protest.
That's correct.
Good. I'm glad to get that record
going
set
out
straight.
There myself personally to both of the protests and saying, look, I'm here and my deputies are here to safeguard your First Amendment rights, not only to protest, to assemble, and freedom of speech. And this information needs to get out to the public. And where's the federal government? Where's the criticism for them not to share this? It's not just because it's Pinal County. There's 3,000 counties in the United States. Do you think the sheriff or a local police chief would want to know this information?
Right. Well, I would think so. Yeah.
Not only that, based on recent history, remember just over a year ago, they released 300 to 400 criminals from prison, a mass release, it turns out, from the Obama administration. Many of them with very serious and violent criminal records,
right,
just released on the street. And they refused to provide me to this minute that we're talking, their names and their full criminal history. Well, and these are criminal illegals.
I would find that, and I've been down this road with DHS myself, because we had a case when I was a news director in Fort Myers where an illegal immigrant whose deportation had been ordered, but who was never deported, and that's because of our lack of political, of diplomatic relations with Cuba. But bottom line is, he had been ordered deported, never was, killed a police officer. And do you think that it was easy or even possible to get answers from DHS? And no. And they, at that time, they were hiding behind written statements, but you could at least get them on the phone. Now, right. I don't have their phone number. Now, of course, I'm not the beat reporter. If I were a beat reporter for this, I would have more contacts, et cetera, et cetera. And I finally did wheedle a phone number out of somebody in the office. But after one 10-second conversation and a promise that I would be called back, haven't heard anything in a couple of days. So I am sympathetic as a journalist to your getting this information and wanting to put it out. Also, as a journalist, I have to ask you the question that I just asked you, which you answered. So now let me ask you another question. You wear two hats, Sheriff. You wear a political hat and you wear a law enforcement hat. So putting on just your law enforcement hat, what are your law enforcement concerns about the possibility of these immigrant children being taken to that ranch?
Stated publicly and directly to DHS that we have confirmed that in Texas, during the screening of these close to 60,000 unaccompanied juveniles from Central America, that there are known gang affiliations. We don't know how many, but this is what I was asking. Qualify those that you're sending. Give us some information. Oh, none of these are, at least not that I would believe them, based on their history here in Pinal County and how they're addressing these issues, but there's no response. And so I want to know who these individuals are, because many friends of mine in Border Patrol, and there's been public statements been made by leaders in Border Patrol of their labor unions, saying that a lot of these individuals have been coached to, when you go to the border and, quote, surrender, claim asylum, that you want to be a refugee and that you're fleeing violence.
Right, that's
right.
Now,
how many of these have been vetted? We haven't vetted any of these yet. Well, they've been given is a permiso, some piece of paper to say you've got some court date, which could be as long as a year from now, to stand an answer for this.
Right, right. Well, we know there's violence in Central America. However, we also know that what's going on right now, this is not fleeing a sudden wave of violence as much as it is suddenly there's a very successful smuggling activity that sprung up. And they're already choreographing their strategy. I mean, we know, okay, take a kid with you, you'll be fine. Or send your kid unaccompanied, the kid will be fine. So we know they're coordinating that strategy. It's certainly not beyond the realm of possibility to believe they're also coordinating with these refugees, or whatever you want to call them, illegal immigrants, to tell a story about fleeing violence. Don't say you're fleeing poverty, because the law gives you no protection if you're just fleeing
right.
poverty. Say you're fleeing violence.
Right.
So it's within the realm of possibility to believe that.
How many children, and tell me if you know, under the age of 18, live in Mexico?
Yeah, don't
there's
know.
40,
right.
no. There's 40 to 50 million.
Yeah, yeah.
The violence from the drug cartels over the last decade, the last just 6 years in Mexico, dwarfs any of the violence in Central America. So how can you or anyone ever try to convince me or somebody else that these people don't have the same legal standing to be able to make the same claim for asylum and refugee status, 40 to 50 million.
Right.
And not that all of them would. So if 100,000 from Mexico just, quote, surrendered at the border and made this claim, can or would President Obama turn them away?
Well, we know the law says that he can, but
not a chance.
This president has
It'll
shown.
It'll never happen.
Yeah.
And that's where what we just did, the very hope was realized. So now the message to not just Mexico, to Central America, is if you make it to the border, literally you're home free.
Right.
And that's where I'm outraged, both as a law enforcement officer and as the elected sheriff. We live in a republic, and as a law enforcement officer, the law applies to you, to me, to every citizen in this country, yet we've arrived at a point where the law, it appears, does not apply to anybody from a foreign country when it comes to immigration.
Right.
There's no consequences for breaking the law. I've got a serious problem with that.
Yeah, of course, should point out at this point, it is a civil violation, not a criminal violation, unless you're a repeat offender. But, Sheriff, let me ask you this. Now, I pointed this out a couple days ago. that when I was coming through Texas on the way home from vacation, there was a big deportation demonstration on one of the overpasses. And one of the signs said the problem is not immigration, it's capitalism. Now, I haven't seen any mainstream reporters, although I don't read necessarily everything on the wide internet, but I haven't seen anybody accusing the immigration sympathizers of inspiring communists. But I read in the paper.
You're coming across broken up. Can you repeat that?
Yeah, I was just saying that I've seen I haven't seen anything, despite signs that have said the immigrants, the problem is not immigration, the problem is capitalism. But I haven't seen any mainstream reporters say that the problem, that the immigration sympathizers are inspiring communists. But I read in the paper yesterday that your calls and your repeated denunciations of smuggling activity in the Baikal Valley are inspiring Nazis. So let me just get you to respond to that. That was in Tim Steller's column yesterday. Sheriff, are you inspiring Nazis?
This is just outrageous. And anybody, and here's what I did. Instead of criticizing the core problem and the fact that we got here, now my response to them sending unannounced, in secret, unaccompanied juveniles here, somehow now I'm the problem for this whole thing. Well, I reject that, and especially not only the Arizona Republic, this Tim Steller, who has a history of writing outrageous claims.
Yeah, Arizona
as well.
Right.
Yeah, it's like this is the guy who, in one case, and this is kind of a funny story, that he asked out one of my female lieutenants, who's married, by the way, on an ice cream date. And because she refused, ever since then, he has been on this rampage with our office because we called him out on it and we said what you did there was inappropriate.
Well, let's assume that, just keeping personal attacks aside, let's assume for a minute, and I've read a lot of Tim's columns and I actually respect a lot of what he says, but in this particular case, I will say that as a fellow journalist, I certainly thought that connecting your calls to stop the drug smuggling and the human smuggling activity in the Baikal Valley to suggest that that's an inspiration to Nazis, I found over the top. And so
anybody, I think, with some sense of fairness looking at these issues, it's over the top. Keep in mind, there were 123,000 illegals, the last public count the Border Patrol gave, just here in the Tucson sector, that were apprehended. We had the largest drug bust in the history of Arizona occurred not in Tucson, not in Pima County, in Pinal County,
right,
okay?
Right.
So
yeah.
When you got guys like Harry Reid that 2 days ago said publicly that he's absolutely convinced that the border is completely secure and there's not a problem at all. He said this.
Yeah, I know.
This is how divorced from reality so many people. So then you get all these people who, anybody who has a different opinion, now they're inciting riots,
right,
and they're un-American for not accepting, or they're not compassionate, and we're cruel towards children. Well, you know, look, bottom line, we're the most generous nation on the face of this earth. And there comes a limit to our generosity. You know, we're the 911 for the rest of the world. What about putting our country and our national interests and our sovereignty and our border security first for once?
Yeah, now we're talking politics, so let me ask you to keep that political hat on. And I want to ask you a question, putting my devil's advocate hat on. Because yesterday I had someone on the show, a couple of people on the show, great compassion in their voices. And they are just, they're focused entirely on the plight of the children, which, you know, is admirable. They think that, you know, politics aside, it doesn't matter. Because I asked a very pointed question. If you help, the more you help now, the more of a message you send to others that they're welcome to. And pretty soon, you know what's going to happen. We're going to be buried under refugees. Does that not concern you? And this person said, really? That's not my problem. My focus is on just helping the people who are here, who are clearly needy. So, facts being facts, they are here. They are needy. The president didn't send them back. The law pretty much says that he can't just send them back if they're unaccompanied. So they're here. We have to deal with them. We have to do so in a humane fashion. So in that context alone, Sheriff, what do you think should be done with these immigrant children? And given the fact that we do have to deal with them and they have to go somewhere, should Arizona not do its fair share?
First, the political side and the fact that I'm a law enforcement official, that is the true essence of not just the office of sheriff. So there's no separating one from the other. This is a republic where the foundation of our nation, we elect the top law enforcement officer of the county, directly answerable to the people we serve. So I always answer with that.
Okay.
So when it comes to this person, they qualified their remarks saying, okay, we're dealing with this humanitarian compartment, yet we're not even concerned about this other issue. Well, bottom line, by doing this, we're in fact not only inviting, but we own all other future problems. And this is where I have a concern, as many other people, that we've done this now. And there's no way that the president or this nation is about to turn away the next wave of 60 to 90,000. What I wish that we had done is place these individuals on an airplane back to their country of origin, and the humanitarian thing to do would be reunite them with their families.
Right. Okay. So, but now the Congress is talking about a law that would actually allow them to do that, because right now the president's view certainly is that he can't, although some feel that he could, that the DHS could interpret the law as it needs to do so. But right now, that's not what they seem to be inclined to do. So
we have emergency. If that is the case, the whole approach he's taking is not to address that issue,
right,
or that concern or the future problems that we're about to have,
right,
is to give them this permiso and let this go on. I support what the senators are planning to do, is to change that immediately. This is urgent. So if we know, and there's some documents and proof that show our federal government were well aware of this crisis at the end of last year, certainly in January, when they started to advertise for escorts for these juveniles, as well as for transportation and all these other concerns. So if we knew back then, how did we not foresee, if the leaders in our country are so bright in understanding these issues, how did we not see that this problem would be coming?
Yeah, exactly.
And why
wouldn't we be
addressing it, not to have it reoccur again?
It's incompetence, and I've certainly written about that and spoken about that. So, but Sheriff, just to make sure I understand you now, so what you would say to the people who were speaking with us on the radio yesterday, you would say, you know, understand your humanitarian concerns, but the thing to do to keep this from getting out of control is to send these folks back now. Am I correct in believing that's your position?
Absolutely. That's what I said just now. That's what I said yesterday. That's what I said when this whole crisis started.
Right.
That don't be sending them to Arizona. Send them back to their country of origin and reunite them with their families there.
Right.
And if we're going to find a way, you look at the larger issue. Yes, there's violence here. There's violence in Mexico. There's violence in just about every country around the world where this argument could be made. So find what the root causes are, find ways diplomatically in a humanitarian way to help the countries there, whether with aid directly, with support, with funding, which we have been very generous to do, to help grow and create jobs for their economy, instead of owning these problems here and wasting $3.7 billion because it's just a one-time fix for the problem, not the core problem. Invest that money into border security so the core problem is finally addressed. That's my, at the bottom of this, is the overall frustration that I have.
Okay. Sheriff, I want to thank you for joining us. We're going to have to take a commercial break now, but you've been very generous with your time and very clear in your views. I want to thank you very much for that.
Okay, take care.
Thanks, Sheriff. You have a great day. Okay, we do have Tim. So, Tim, thanks for joining us. I really appreciate you taking time out to join us this morning to talk about the column from a couple days ago. And let me hear from you exactly what you think about what the sheriff did. You used words, I think some of the words you used was sleight of hand or something like that, where he's, in your view, he was portraying himself as a public safety, a public law enforcement official concerned about public safety, while at the same time taking steps that maybe serve to undermine that. So let me hear from you your thinking on that.
Yeah, well, it's not that complicated. Without Sheriff Babu raising the alarm about these Central American teens or whatever age people they are, nobody would have known about it. Now, he has said that this is he was trying to be transparent, and that's something I've covered him for years, that whenever he wants to score a political point and reveal something, he says he's just doing it for transparency. So this is nothing new. And so he started the thing, and then he arrived and presented himself as a sort of peacemaker and protector of constitutional rights. The thing I find interesting is to wonder why this particular migrant wave has had detainees. We've had detainees around Arizona and in other parts of the country. Why is it there have been no protests anywhere else? And the simple answer is that Sheriff Babu rallied the protests.
Right.
And then since he's a law enforcement, chief law enforcement officer for that area, then of course it is his duty to ensure peace is kept, et cetera. So that allows him to play, a healthy role, two healthy roles. One, stirring up the anger that gets him support, and the other, being the kind of authority figure that he likes to project.
Now, Tim, I asked him that very directly, and I asked him, Sheriff, did you instigate anything? And it's been reported or suggested that you called your friend Bob Skiba and saw to it that the protest would happen. Did you do that? He flat out said he didn't do that. He said the only comments he made were in public at a public gathering.
Sure, yeah. Those two things. The denial is a denial of something that is not what I'm accusing him of.
Okay.
Both Steve Lemons up at the Phoenix New Times and Veronica Cruz, my colleague here at the Star, talked to Mr. Skiba and got pretty similar stories, which was that Babu mentioned this arrival at a public meeting last week sometime, and also made special note to get the message across at that meeting to Mr. Skiba. So the fact that it was in public is true, absolutely.
Yeah.
And,
but you just think it was orchestrated and convenient.
That doesn't mean he didn't start it.
Yeah,
he did.
Right. Now, let me ask you this. We're both journalists, and we have different backgrounds, but you're now in a position where you're able to give opinions, and I was under constraints for 33 years of my career where I wasn't able to do that, but now I can. So we're both journalists. We both dealt all our careers with public officials, and right now, for instance, it's very hard to get information from DHS on what's going on. I've had a really interesting experience where I'm not a regular beat reporter, so I don't necessarily have a reporter's Rolodex for all the good numbers to have. It's been impossible, and DHS's so-called press office doesn't even have a publicly listed number, and they won't give it to you if you call their public affairs office. So it's been very difficult to get information from the government. Historically, I have found that some public officials are open, some are not. I've always applauded, as a journalist, public officials who will give you the information. So here we have a public official who gave the information. As a journalist who is a seeker of information, do you feel that in this instance it was appropriate for him to have done that, or should he have kept this information to himself?
It's a really tough question. I think there's, I guess the idea that he disclosed this information in a spirit of transparency, there's an argument for that, no question.
Right, yeah.
But the underlying idea is that there is a public safety concern. And we have detention centers all around Pima County. We have a huge Border Patrol detention center. We have them in Nogales. People are being detained in many places. This Sycamore Canyon Academy is apparently a secure facility. So I don't know, we don't. The sheriff of Pima, the sheriff of Santa Cruz counties, they don't tell us every time detainees are taken from one detention center to another. It suggests that there is something to be worried about. And I don't know why. I don't see anything to back up that suggestion that there was a concern. Now, leave that aside for a minute. DHS is horrible in terms of transparency.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not the only one to say this.
No, you're not.
It's widely known. I've written many columns about it.
Yeah.
So I don't feel that they are somehow in the right in being in obfuscating. So it's a question of what you do with the information. And of course, I've said my opinion. My opinion is that he released it in such a way to provoke a response that would then, propel him politically. And that's backed up. I, in the column, I said that, you know, it would help fundraising, and that that was part of the plan here. And lo and behold, the next day, that is yesterday, Sheriff Babu put out a fundraising email, an email and a Facebook post. In the email, he cites the Oracle protest, says things are out of control.
Yeah.
Well, sure. Raises it was, alarm, right. Raises hysteria.
It was definitely political.
Says, give me money.
Right. There's know? No.
So
there's no.
You got to wonder. Was that the plan all along?
Right. It without a doubt, it was political in nature. It's still an open question as to whether that was inappropriate because he's sheriff, he's a politician. But without a doubt, he had political. I would say it's probably a fair criticism that he had politics in mind. So let me ask you this,
yep.
Tim. One thing in your column that I did think was I just say that I disagree with and.
Okay.
You said that the sheriff inspired JT Reddy, that he inspired this Nazi killer. Is that fair? I mean, because, you know, every movement attracts extremists.
I'm not saying a couple of people have pointed that out, and I want to be very clear. Apparently, I didn't make it clear enough. I am not saying he inspired Reddy to kill anybody.
No.
It
doesn't say that. And it doesn't say that you said
that. But he inspired Reddy to act. I mean, and this is a double game he's been playing for years, appearing on extremist radio shows, even really obscure internet radio shows and such, while at the same time making good with the Republican establishment. So I would say, yes, he inspired Reddy to do these patrols, no question. Babu is the only reason that people knew about the Vicol Valley at that time.
But Tim, wouldn't it be fair to say that it's the sheriff's duty to issue calls and raise an alarm when their smuggling is out of control, which it is in the Vicol Valley? I mean, it seems to me, and the reason that I found that one a little bit harder to swallow is because, in my opinion, it's the sheriff's duty to speak out about lawbreaking. He speaks out about lawbreaking. And then you've got an extremist like JT Reddy who reacts to that. But I question the connection between what the sheriff was saying and JT Reddy, the Nazi killer.
Well, no, I'm just saying that those people are receptive to his message. There's no question they've responded down through the years. And that's what I mean when I say he inspired them. They respond to what he's saying.
Okay.
Now, that doesn't mean other people who aren't off the wall also don't also respond.
Right.
I'm just saying that he's playing with fire when he raises these emotions. And that I think it's irresponsible for a law enforcement officer to do that, to sow these social divisions when he should be the peacemaker that he pretended to be at the protest.
Tim, we've got about a minute left, and you know the sheriff's department, and you're a student of it. I know you know this. Sometimes when they react to criticism, it can get personal. And I regret to inform you that the sheriff took a real personal shot at you this morning. He claims your entire reason for being mad at him was because somebody in his office turned down a request for a date. So let me get you to respond to that. We got about 60 seconds left.
Oh, that is wonderful. So this is a great example of what's wrong with the sheriff's department. So once upon a time, he had a spokeswoman who essentially was fired from her position as spokeswoman. And I saw an opportunity and called her and said, hey, can we get together? Because you were, essentially, I was trying to recruit a source, you know, to put it bluntly. And then at some point after that, she was asked if she had had any contact with the Star or any media people, and she said, we had agreed to get together, but we never even did. And so I find it insane that the Tim Gaffney, who's been...
About 15 seconds left, Tim.
The spokesman posted this online. It's just not true that there was... The suggestion is that there was a date involved, which is not the case, and she confirms that.
Okay.
I could get Tim, her
we,
to tell
we,
you
we
that
have to
if
go.
You wanted to. It's just ridiculous. They were trying to find a way to get more information from the sheriff's department, something I do all the time.
Tim, you've been great. I respect a lot of what you say, disagree with you sometimes. I appreciate you calling, and I hope we have more conversations in the future. Really appreciate you participating in the show.
Okay, thanks.
We are out of time.